So, welcome to this 12th lecture. In the 11th lecture, what we saw was that in order to get the solution for any partial differential equation in electromagnetics, we have to basically minimize the energy. So, when we say minimize the energy, we have to basically make variation in F equal to 0. That will make this F as stationary. Stationary means the energy is minimum, and that energy minimum condition is given by this. When this F, capital F of phi plus del phi minus F of phi, when that becomes 0, then we get energy minimum condition. And then we also saw that F of phi plus del phi is nothing but this, wherein del of x is equal to 0, because we are not varying x. What we are doing is, at every x we are varying the potential phi plus del phi. So, we are varying the potential at every point, and the corresponding derivative of potential also will get varied, and we are finding a combination of potentials at various points which will result into energy minimum condition. Right. Also, remember this capital F is the energy or energy functional, and that is integral F dx for one dimensional case. Right. Now, this F, small f, is in general function of x, phi, phi dash, but in case of Laplace equation, it is just function of only phi dash. Right. In case of Poisson's equation, it will be function of phi and phi dash. Then we also saw in the process of this minimization, this whole del F equal to 0, that leads to what is known as Euler-Lagrange equation. Euler-Lagrange equation is this bracket equal to 0, bracketed term is equal to 0 is the Euler-Lagrange equation, whereas this bracket, only bracket I am calling as Euler-Lagrange expression, right. So, this we already seen. And this equation is important, we will use this equation later also. Now, little bit more insight into what we have seen till now. Now, you know, this Euler-Lagrange expression is this for a one dimensional case. Now, in Cartesian system, we know small f is half epsilon e square, which is incidentally energy density in electrostatics, right. And then that is given by E is replaced by del V. So, you get this expression, and del V square is dabba V by dabba V square in case of one dimensional problem. So, now, so Euler-Lagrange expression is this. In that, actually, if you substitute now F, which is given by this here, you will get minus epsilon dabba 2 V by dabba X square, right. This can be easily verified. Now, let us understand little bit more about the whole concept. We also saw that if we know the exact solution, and that is substituted in this small f, and that in turn is substituted in Euler-Lagrange equation,
we get left hand side of Laplace equation.
Small f for electrostatic problem, 1D electrostatic problem is this, that we substituted in Euler-Lagrange expression, we get this, right. And it is natural that we are getting this, because we already know that energy related to one dimensional electrostatic problem is this. Now, if we actually substitute V is equal to X, which is the actual solution in case of parallel plate capacitor, a parallel plate capacitor a problem, we know that the potential, suppose you know the in parallel plate capacitor problem, which is you know, in which two plates, top and bottom plates are say are having potentials of 10 volts and 0 volt, right. And if the distance between the two plates is 10 meters, then every equipotential line say 9, 8, 7, 6 volts will be at corresponding meters of 9, 8, 7, 6. So, effectively what we are having is the exact or actual solution for that parallel plate capacitor problem will be simply V equal to X. So, at whatever distance you have, at 5 meters from the ground plate, you will have 5 volts and likewise, right? So V equal to X is the solution for that simple electrostatic problem without fringing, right? Considered, without fringing effects considered at the ends. Now, if you substitute V equal to X in this Euler-Lagrange expression, we immediately get this whole thing equal to 0, because V is equal to X and this becomes equal to 0. And that means what we are seeing here, the Laplace equation is exactly satisfied. So, since we already know the exact solution and then we substitute it there, it is but natural that we are exactly satisfying the Laplace equation. And that in fact is happening because when this is being made, this is equal to 0, in turn Euler-Lagrange expression is 0. Euler-Lagrange expression equal to 0 means del capital F is equal to 0. Okay. So, the whole theory that we saw is seen to be consistent for, you know, Laplace equation, simple Laplace equation solution involving parallel plate capacitor problem. Now, let us see if suppose we substitute in this F and correspondingly in Euler-Lagrange expression V as X raised to 0.9, that means we are not actually substituting the exact solution that we know, but we are substituting approximate solution, this approximate solution, right. Now, actually if you substitute V is equal to X raised to 0.9 and now you substitute it here, this expression is equal to this, you can verify it easily, and this is not equal to 0. That means Euler-Lagrange expression is not coming equal to 0. That is why Laplace equation also will not get exactly satisfied, because here this will not be equal to 0, right? Because obviously, because we have assumed some solution which is not the exact solution. So, this is what is called as, you know, this will be the corresponding, you know, this will be representing the error at every point, but that error can be minimized by, you know, approximating a solution which is more closer to the exact solution by having more terms. Here we have just substituted X raised to 0.9, but if you assume a polynomial, of course, here it is a trivial solution V is equal to X, that is why this question does not arise, but imagine there is a complicated electrostatic problem wherein there is non-uniform field distribution, then you know you will have to assume V as some complicated polynomial of X, and that when you actually go through this entire procedure and minimize, you will get an error which can be very small, and that can be further reduced by using FEM procedure in which you know fine discretization can be done. So, now going further, this equation we have already, you know, seen on the previous one of the previous slides, this is that expression. When energy is getting minimized, you have this expression which is rewritten here for 1D case. Correspondingly for 2D case, you will have two independent variables X and Y, and this equation will get modified to this equation. And noting here that G is nothing but del phi, variation in phi, right. Now, the question that will arise is, for one dimensional electrostatic problem, we knew the energy density expression as half epsilon E square, but if you want to find out energy functional for a given PDE, then how do we, you know, do that? So, that is done by using the following procedure. So, now our, you know, goal is to find functional for a given PDE, right. So, we will consider first Poisson's equation, right, and then we will when actually you substitute the a known f function, right, if that f function is exact, if f function is exact, and when I say f function is exact, function that energy density function is known, and then you are substituting the correct potential solution there, then you will get del square minus del square phi minus h is equal to 0. So, now in this two dimensional expression equation involving del f, which is variation in energy, being made equal to 0, if we know f and that if you substitute it in this expression, we will get minus del square phi minus h. As we have seen in the previous case, when we knew this expression and when we substituted in this Euler-Lagrange expression, we got the corresponding Laplace equation form, right. So, similarly here, if we know f corresponding to the Poisson's equation and if you substitute it here, you will get this bracket, bracketed term as equal to minus del square phi minus h. And remember, this g is replaced here by del phi, right. Now, again, this is same concept is summarized here. If this phi now, which is there in this small f, if that phi is exact solution, then del square phi will be equal to minus h, and this equation gets exactly satisfied, and then that is why this minus del square phi minus h will be equal to 0, and you will get automatically del f, capital F equal to 0. But in that expression of f, the expression of f is known, but in that if we substitute phi, approximate solution phi tilde as solution which is not exact, but some approximate solution, then minus del square phi minus h will not be equal to 0, and that will be equal to some residue at every point in the domain, right. So, that is why when you actually force this del f equal to 0 in the process of energy minimization, what effectively you are forcing is area integral of r del phi equal to 0, right. And this in fact we will see later for one dimensional problem that indeed when we approximate solution which is not exact, we get residue, and that integral of residue del phi dx equal to 0 in one dimensional case, right. Also, one more point I want to say here. Now, here r is unit of source, it is charge in electrostatic. Why? Because here when del square, this h represents charge, because del square phi equal to minus rho upon epsilon naught. So, basically h is a function of charge, although it is rho upon epsilon naught. But
if epsilon naught is absorbed here, then
you can take this as h as simply charge, right. So, this has unit of charge. So, r also, since h and r they appear like this, r also will have unit of charge. And now, this charge into this potential V is basically the energy, work or energy, right. So, that del of residual energy integrated over the domain is being equated to 0. So, that is the second interpretation of this equation, right. More about this when we solve one 1D problem, and then we will again see this being enforced in the formulation there, okay. So, now going further, we again then start with the same equation that we saw previously. We go further now, and then what we do is we basically substitute in place of del square phi, we substitute del square phi by this, and then h del phi we are separating out here. Now, what we do, this expression we are actually splitting it as difference of these two, and then remember this we are taking only the first integral here, that is being split into two, right. And then this first term here is basically replaced by this by using simple divergence theorem, because divergence of this you can see it is this bracketed expression. Now, what we will do, this expression here, so the internal term here, this bracketed term we will further simplify on the next slide. For that we need to understand little bit again basics of what is meant by del capital F. Now, variation in f, del f is given by this. Now, here as I have mentioned previously, there is no daba f by daba x into del x term, because del x is equal to 0 in this variational calculus, right, in the variational procedure. So now if F for capital F, for example, is dabba u by dabba x square, which is nothing but u dash square, u dash is dabba u by dabba x, then del of u dash square by this formula is simply this, right? And now the first term is 0 because this u dash square is not function of u. So this goes to 0. So only this term remains as written here, and that can be simplified to twice u dash del u dash, and now u dash is replaced by dabba u by dabba x in this in this right hand side, right. Now let us further simplify. We now to have to substitute this by something else, which we will see now. Now let us take del of dabba u by dabba x square, as we can see it is twice dabba u by dabba x into del of dabba u by dabba x, right. Now this is nothing but twice dabba u by dabba x into
dabba by dabba x of del u, because the del operator can be taken inside, since by definition it does not involve variation with x.
This expression, the whole thing then just becomes half del of dabba phi by dabba x square. Similarly, when the second term here, which is in y, that can be written as this. Simply, you know, you replace x by y, you will get it this, right. Now del f1, now what is this f1? F1 we are calling this is the whole f. Now we are calling this only this term as corresponding to del f1. So this is del f1. So that del f1 now reduces to, because of these two substitutions now here for these two terms, right, you get the expression here as this, right. And this first term here, which was replaced by this divergence, comes here as it is, right. But here what else we are doing? This now we are invoking the divergence theorem, because here it is divergence of some vector dx dy, is it not? Integral divergence of this is replaced by the corresponding contour integral. We have seen in basics of electromagnetics, when we saw the theory, when divergence theorem is invoked, the volume integral got converted into closed surface integral. Here now it is a two dimensional problem, but effectively it is a 3D problem with dx dy into 1. That means it is a per unit dimension in z direction. So this is basically volume will get converted into surface, open surface. But here, since it is a already surface with two dimensional approximation, a closed surface in divergence theorem will get replaced by closed contour here, right. So here that is why you have dot closed contour integral, that vector dot a n hat d tau, right. Now we consider this second integral of is del f1, capital F1, which is given by this. Now here again, for understanding this, how to evaluate, we will consider a standard our capacitor problem geometry. This is a parallel plate capacitor with potential specified on these 1 and 2 segments, and homogeneous Neumann boundary conditions specified on vertical segments 3 and 4, as we have seen earlier. Right, I will explain you what about this open surface and closed surface little later. First, let us understand, you know, this closed contour is made up of these 4 segments, 1, 2, 3 and 4, right. So on segments 1 and 2, potentials are specified. So del of phi will be equal to 0, because there is no variation, we are not varying phi there, it is fixed, we are already specifying. So it del phi will be 0 on segments 1 and 2 of this closed contour, 1, 3, 2, 4, right. Now when it comes to segment 3, which is vertically down, d tau bar is d tau a n hat, right? So that is, you know, this
d tau is
minus dy, because this is vertically down, so that's why minus dy. And a n hat for this segment 3 is basically minus a x hat. Why? Because remember, we obtained this by invoking divergence theorem. So that's why the divergence theorem is applied for a volume integral, and volume integral gets converted to closed surface integral. But now, since we are having a 2D approximation of the problem, what happens is the surface integral gets converted to open surface integral, gets converted to closed contour integral, right? So now that's why you have got the closed contour here. But we should remember, in actual 3D case, this is really a closed, is not just closed contour, but it's a closed surface as shown here. So it is a closed surface, is it not? This cubic surface, right? So now the normal to this segment 3 is effectively normal to this surface, right? Because the what is there in the third dimension is this, and the corresponding this surface is there.
We know that normal for a face of any closed surface is outward normal. Therefore, for
segment 3, normal actually is this outward normal in minus ax direction. So that's why here it is ax hat. One of these terms will not contribute, because this is an hat is minus ax hat, and here when it is
multiplied with
ay hat, the dot product will be 0. So only this term will contribute. So that's why only daba phi by daba x phi into this dy will remain. So this minus sign is coming from, there is a minus sign here, right? There is a minus sign here. So that's why this minus sign is for that, and this minus becomes plus. Remember, this minus come, sign is coming from this minus sign, right? So similarly, on contour 4, segment 4, this is the segment 4, and the corresponding surface will be this, will be the surface, right? And the corresponding outward normal will be this. So the outward normal will be ax hat, this will be ax hat, right? And then
d tau
will be, because this is vertically up integration, so plus dy. And again, you know, this term will not contribute, because the dot product will be 0. So again, you get the same thing. And then here, since daba phi by daba x in both these cases is 0, because we have imposed homogeneous Neumann condition on this, is it not? We have got this
equipotential lines
which are entering normally. That means that daba phi by daba x is 0. So that's why here also it is 0, here also it is 0 on both 3 and 4. So that's why these two integrations on this 3 and 4 reduce to 0 identically. That's why this whole term doesn't contribute in this case of capacitor, right? It doesn't contribute anything. But in case you have some domain and some boundary wherein homogeneous Neumann condition is not there, some non-zero Neumann condition is there, then this term will be non-zero, and this will be the additional term in the energy expression, and correspondingly in the FEM equation, the last set of equation, which is linear system of equation, you will get additional matrix term corresponding to this, and that has to be taken into account. More about, you know, how do we form matrices in FEM procedure, we will see later as we go further in this course. Going further, so now you have this F for Poisson's equation. Now what we saw, the whole this expression del F1 reduces to only this. When you have the vertical boundaries in that case with homogeneous Nyman conditions, you get only this, because this will become 0. Remember, if there are no homogeneous Nyman conditions somewhere, right, then this term also will be there, and then there will be additional term in F1, and you know this del F1, right. But here, for the in most of the cases, what we solve, we generally have, for example, you know, in case of either homogeneous, we will have either homogeneous Nyman condition where boundary conditions are not defined, or generally we, you know, enclose the entire our problem domain into a box or a rectangle, and we specify reference potential as phi equal to 0 or a equal to 0. So, in that process, you know, this term will go down to 0 because there is a del phi. So, whenever generally we have, whenever boundary is there, we either have, in most of the problems, we either have either Dirichlet condition wherein phi is specified, or homogeneous Nyman condition, and that's why this integral will reduce to 0 and only this will remain, right. So, now this F1, you have del F1, you have only this term remaining, and then we had seen the whole expression F had this second term. Now, that we take here, and that term is simply, you know, is minus twice phi h. So, this is h. So, this will be twice because here we have taken half. So, that is why it is the same term, right, we are taking. And remember, this h represents the source in case of electrostatic problem. So, it will be simply minus rho v upon epsilon in case of electrostatics. And then also remember that in the functional expression, as mentioned previously, the terms involving h or source or any some constant term or any other term which is not phi, suppose here in this case it was on the right hand side of the Poisson's equation, it was only L h, is it not, minus del square phi minus h is equal to 0. So, del square phi was equal to minus h, that minus h gets multiplied by phi in the energy expression, right. So, phi into h. Now, same logic now we will apply for magnetostatic Poisson's equation. We know the governing partial differential equation is del square A equal to minus mu j, right. And now, if we are doing two dimensional approximation, then we will take always cross section which is perpendicular to current, is it not. So, if we actually see in any two dimensional problem, you will always find, suppose you are analyzing some electrical machine or transformer or any other, you know, device, and if there is some current distribution, you will always find that we take a cross section which is perpendicular to the current. So, either we will show dot and cross, is it not, always we take a cross section which is perpendicular to the current, right. And then we approximate it as a 2D problem. So, always here current, so this is x, y plane. So, current is in z direction. So, I has only z component. So, similarly, A will also have only z component, because direction of magnetic vector potential is direction of I. So, effectively what is happening? A, basically the direction gets fixed. So, what needs to be determined is only the magnitude. So, only the magnitude of this A needs to be found out at every point in the domain. So, effectively this becomes a scalar formulation, because direction is already known. So, only we have to find out the magnitude of A at every point. So, that is the advantage of using magnetic vector potential formulation in two dimensional magnetic field problems, because the direction of current and therefore direction of magnetic vector potential gets fixed, because we take the cross section perpendicular to the current, and AZ, the direction of A becomes fixed in Z direction. So, only the magnitude remains to be determined at all points in the domain. It is domain everywhere A, magnitude of AZ needs to be determined. Once the magnitude of AZ is known, you can find out BX and BY, because see, current is in Z direction. So, B will be in X and Y direction in this, because the flux lines are going to be like this, is it not, in general. So, B will have X and Y components. So, X and Y components of B can be determined from A by using the expression B is equal to del cross A. How do you do that? We will see later when we get into finite element analysis. Thank you.